Myself, Dr. Vinodini, I welcome you all on behalf of IHMA Kerala State Chapter. IHMA Kerala State Chapter has conducted a series of 50 sessions of Season 1 of free webinar. And this is the Season 2 of free webinars conducted by IHMA Kerala State Chapter. And dear delegates, this Season 2 of free webinars will end by this July 25. And only the permitted recordings alone will be uploaded in the YouTube, because some recordings consist of the information of the patients which cannot be disclosed in the internet. And before starting the session, we should remember our master, Dr. Samuel Hahnemann, and we should owe all our credits to our master for introducing the world a greater holistic system called homeopathy. And today's speaker, we have Dr. Shalini ma'am. And today's topic is homeopathic approach to rectal hemorrhoids. I would like to introduce the speaker for today. Dr. Shalini ma'am is a homeopathic consultant with more than 12 years of experience in the field of homeopathy. She is an alumni of the prestigious Government Homeopathic Medical College, Trivandrum, Kerala. She has also completed her MBA from Indian Institute of Health Management and Research. She is a staunch believer and propagator of homeopathy. She takes homeopathy awareness seminars and classes at various platforms. She is author of articles and creator of homeopathic informative videos in Dr. Shalini's Homeopathy Clinic YouTube channel. She aims to make people choose homeopathy as the first choice of treatment. Ma'am, it is our privilege to have you in today's session, ma'am. Thanks for accepting the invite, ma'am. Please, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Vinodini, Dr. Rekha, ma'am, can you tell a few words with Dr. Shalini, ma'am? I think, yeah.
Yeah, good afternoon. Hope I am audible.
Yes, ma'am.
Actually, I am very proud of Dr. Shalini. She is one among our group of doctors who has written one article about comorbidities in autism spectrum disorders and how to tackle it in our upcoming book on treating autism spectrum disorders with homeopathy for the homeopathic doctors. And she is very enthusiastic, very bright, as well as very hardworking. And all the best, Shalini. All the best.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Okay. Dr. Deepu, shall I start? Before I start, I would like to really thank IHMA and most important, Dr. Rekha ma'am, for giving me this opportunity and making sure that I'm able to perform and make this presentation done. Thanks once again for inviting me on this platform. I hope I can do justice. So let's start the session. The session actually is divided into two parts. The first part is the theoretical part, because I like our master believes that we need to understand what the disease is, the exact disease condition, the clinical condition. Then only we'll be able to diagnose the condition and understand whether it's incurable, not curable, the parameter, our limitations, etc. And then we'll move on to the homeopathic approach. So let's start. I'll just start speaking. At any point of time, Dr. Deepu and others, if you feel that I'm moving a bit fast, please do let me know. I'll just slow down. Okay?
Sure, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you. And thank you, Dr. Vinodini, for that wonderful info that you have given to me. I really appreciate
it. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. So, before I move on, hemorrhoid condition, it's a very common condition, to be honest. It's prevalent and its distribution is all over the world. It's a global condition, not exactly due to a very severity in the health concern, not that. It is primarily a condition which affects the quality of life, unless and until the gradation goes into the more complicated state. So initially, or the primary state, or the symptomatic state, is what is discomfort is all about. But the discomfort affects the quality of life, and hence, this condition is very common in almost all stream of medicines, even ours. So basically, what do you mean by hemorrhoid? Okay. I'm not able to move the screen. Yes. So before I move, I would like to bow my head to our master, because of whom we are here. We have come to know, even the world has recognized and trying to understand how different and effective our spring medicine is. Now, hemorrhoids is a part of our, as an anatomy, it is very normal anatomical structure that is there in our body. Okay, it's actually a mix or a blend of group of blood vessels that's located in the smooth vessel walls. And I'll just use my attention. I can't use my notation here. Can you? Is there something that you are prohibiting, Doctor? Before you have to share
annotation. Annotation. Okay, you wanted me to enable an annotation.
Yes, please.
But I think it's very difficult, ma'am. Actually, we have disabled that in our
network. No problem.
You can point out the mouse. You can point out the mouse, and people also can zoom the session. No problem. Okay.
No problem. Yeah.
People can zoom the screen.
Yeah, no problem. I'll just use the mouse for that. See, so like you say, there's a division. This is the basic part that we are going to be. This is the whole topic of us, the hemorrhoids. It's divided into, like, it's visible internal hemorrhoids as well as external hemorrhoids. Now, these particular names that we are on the picture is what we will be dealing with in depth as we move on to the presentation. So, these hemorrhoids, like I said, are very common anorectal condition, which is a symptomatic enlargement. Okay, it's not something, if it is asymptomatic, people are least bothered about it. Because 40% of the cases nearly are asymptomatic, and people don't even recognize they are having it. But when it becomes symptomatic, when it causes a symptomatic enlargement, there's a displacement. Let's not focus about the distal distance. There's a displacement that is happening in the cushions, anal cushions. Now, what is anal cushion? Most of the doctors or physicians, we may just forget this anal cushion concept, because I genuinely did forget about anal cushion concept. We do have a vague idea that we have this hemorrhoidal pads or cushions inside the rectum. Now, this is anatomically three. Internal hemorrhoids have three divisions. Okay? Three divisions, that those are the anal cushions for the divisions. Now, hemorrhoids only becomes an issue. It only becomes an issue when it becomes to swell. And it causes symptoms, like any other condition. Any symptom is only whenever it comes, only there is sort of a discomfort, and we value that particular organ or that particular part of the body. So, only that time itself is hemorrhoid becoming the problematic issue. We'll discuss about the epidemiology, which I have given a bit in the introduction. Incidence is difficult to evaluate because it's global, globally distributed, but approximately the prevalence is about 5%. There is a common age group where we see it happening between 45 to 65 years, and very unusual to see it below 20 years. Now, here I thought of something interesting, that most of the studies have said that women and men are equally predisposed. But there have been few studies where in the hospital studies, they have mentioned that men, in the hospital-based recorded studies, men are more prone into this. Why I have a theory on that is, if you see anthropologically or historically speaking, the women have a tendency to brush off these conditions. Since there's an attachment of shame when it comes to something which is very private to us. So it's about all conditions, not only hemorrhoids in particular. So as a reason, as compared to men, women, they don't open up and they don't come and admit themselves or are vocal about these complaints, and eventually they don't get treatment, at least in the initial stages, when they're just facing a slight discomfort. When the situation grades into too much, into in-depth or further duration happens, like other conditions, they'll come. Now, like I said, in second sense, in community-based studies, they have found out that women and men are equally affected. Now, there is also socioeconomic status, like this is prolonged sitting or prolonged standing. It causes downward pressure and downward discomfort along the position of the rectum as well as the sitting position. Now, this is the sitting position through which we pass, we defecate normal, the vestibulized, lavatory that we are using. That itself is an issue. That itself is a cause that that leads to hemorrhoidal or a displacement of the normal hemorrhoidal cushions or anal cushions of our body. Now we move on to the anatomy. I'll try to move this a bit fast because our topic is on the approach. Now, can you see this is how this is exactly the three.
Can I tell you something?
Yeah.
Can you keep the mobile a bit closer? The sound is very much echo is there. I think if you can keep that bit closer to you.
I'll do one thing.
Okay. Can you use headset or anything?
Now am I audible?
Yeah, it's very clear now.
Okay. Okay.
Also, you haven't started your video, Shalini.
Actually, I have shared it. I'll just reshare it.
Yeah.
No. Your video is not on. Only slides is
there. No, she already on that from the other
laptop.
Side. No problem.
Laptop.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, screen is clear for all.
Yes,
the screen. It's clear. You can.
Yeah, I think there's one thing that I forgot about my specs. Yeah, okay, so now audio is clear. Everything is fine. So let's move again.
Yes, ma'am. Please, ma'am.
Sure, thank you. Now, see if you can see anatomically. That's the picture that you can see on the left side of the screen. That is about the cushion or anal cushion that I was telling from the start of the session. The hemorrhoidal tissue. That the space is covered with hemorrhoidal tissue as well as there is a hemorrhoidal vasculature. Okay, now the hemorrhoidal tissue doesn't have much structure. It just is, there's no uniformity in its appearance. On the contrary, the hemorrhoidal vascular tissue, which we already we can say as anal cushion, has a particular shape. The hemispherical masses it is. Okay, hemispherical mass, and these cushions are well-shaped, deep purple in color, and it protrudes towards the lumen of the surgical anal canal. Now, what it is, this you can see the first circle is anal verge, second one is the pectinate line, and the third one is the anorectal ring. Now, it actually divides this thing into the anal cushion into the three parts. The first one is known as the pedicle. Second one, that is the body of the internal hemorrhoid, and the last one, which actually goes inside the lumen, towards the lumen of the, is known as the external hemorrhoidal part. Yeah. Now, on the right side of the screen, you can see the internal hemorrhoids that arise. Now, this you can see the dentate line, which we have mentioned here also in the previous slide. That is the pectinate line as well as the dentate line, both are the same. This division actually divides the internal as well as the external hemorrhoids. And the hemorrhoid, that's the three anal cushion that I've been mentioning, is above the pectinate line or the dentate line. Now this dentate line and the division, the lower one will become the external hemorrhoid. That's all. Something that is dividing up top is the internal and bottom is the external one. Now, despite these being tissues that are predominantly vascular in origin, like I said, that is, it's vascular in origin, there are certain parts of this internal hemorrhoids which are avascular. Now, the complication usually arises more for the internal hemorrhoids in those aspects, where there's ischemia will develop in later, strangulation will happen, gangrene may occur. This all basically, it revolves around those avascular parts. I'm not saying it's not there for the hemorrhoidal or the vasculature part, but these more complications for, I'm talking in terms of internal hemorrhoids, it happens on the avascular issues. Now, if we look into this blood supply, the internal hemorrhoids basically is supplied from superior rectal artery. I'm talking about the arteries first, venous we'll take the next slide. Superior rectal artery, along with a branch of middle rectal artery. Now, these two will form a plexus sort of thing, mostly behind the rectum. And from there, it gives three branches. Three branches, it just goes out and it goes into, settles into this hemorrhoidal plexus. That is the internal hemorrhoidal vasculature that creates. It settles into 3 o'clock, 7 o'clock, and 11 o'clock. That is the position of this plexus formed. Now the 3 o'clock, we can say left lateral, 7 o'clock is right posterior, and 11 o'clock is a right anterior. Okay. Now, that's what pretty much I have mentioned in this slide. Now, we'll talk about the external one. I have mentioned about the internal hemorrhoidal plexus. Now, the external one is given by the inferior rectal artery. The drainage is also pretty much the same, as you can know. Now, if you move on to the drainage part, I'll just move on to the, since I have mentioned the arterial part of the external also, I'll just explain about the drainage of the venous part. The venous part for the internal hemorrhoids, the drainage happens inside this plexus. So this gets inside and sinusoids are formed. What are sinusoids? Sinusoids are a part of capillaries having a bit larger diameter. This artery, that is the three lateral branches, the single branch, it just goes into a capillary sort of formation, and for the drainage, you know, the arteriovenous exchange happens inside that plexus, inside that, that's the anal cushion, along with the connective tissue, along with the muscle, Thoracic muscle, it forms that cushion. So this exchange, look, the draining off of the blood from the arteries to that of the venous drainage happens, and it is collected for the internal hemorrhage through superior as well as middle rectal vein, and the external through the inferior rectal vein. That's all. Superior and middle rectal artery supplies to the internal, and inferior rectal artery supplies the external. The same way the venous drainage happens. The only difference is that for the venous drainage, if we just move on, the superior rectal vein, it drains into the porous secretion. Okay, whereas the middle as well as the inferior rectal vein, it drains into the inferior mesenteric venous vein. Further then, it carries it to the inferior common iliac vein and then to the inferior vena cava. Am I clear so much? Or do you want, anybody wants me to repeat? Because I can't see chat out here. Dr. Dibu, feel free to let me know if somebody wants to repeat a particular slide once again.
No problem. You can continue with this space. Okay. No problem.
Thank you. Thank you. Now, it's all this hype around this anal cushion. Like we say, that is the primary thing that we are having a discussion about. That is the hemorrhoid. That basically is the hemorrhoid. And any alteration, any symptomatic change happening in that particular cushion, those particular cushions are giving us the hemorrhoidal condition or hemorrhoidal diseases. Now, what is the role of this anal cushion, if you ask us? It helps in the continence, you know, the stool or the defecation or the waste product continence is what its primary role is about. Basically, the internal anal sphincter covers the 60 to 80% of the closure thing, but remaining 50 to 20% is covered by this cushions. Now, the smooth functioning of this when it happens, without any much of the constipation, without much of the straining, without less, not proper amount of intra-abdominal pressure, the process is continues without much of a harm. Now, I'm just going to have a relation. I'm going to tell you the relation between the anatomical safety points as well as the physiological, output of or the relation with these two. Now, the four anatomical safety points, actually what it intends is, this whole thing, or these three cushions of the internal hemorrhoids, these are not sitting comfortably with the help of multiple musculature or too many muscle stiffeners or cells with strong things are being attached. No, it has been, it's a very complex thing that has been attached. So any damage in the four of the anatomical safety measures that I'm going to explain will lead to the hemorrhoidal condition or hemorrhoidal disease condition. The first one that we need to understand is the integrity of the accompanying connective tissue found between the sinusoids. Like I said, sinusoids happen inside that hemorrhoidal plexus, and any integrity with the surrounding connective tissue, loss of it will cause the condition, hemorrhoid condition. Second one is the anatomical integrity of the Thoracic muscle. The Thoracic muscle and the conjoined longitudinal muscle. The Thoracic muscle, it has a role. It separates into two branches. One of the branches, it goes and fixes itself into the floor of the internal hemorrhoidal plexus. That is our internal anal sphincter. There it goes, fixes. Second one, it goes, penetrates and attaches itself, penetrates the internal sphincter, anal sphincter, and attaches itself to the conjoined longitudinal muscle. That is a suspensory ligament. It's also known as Parkes ligament.
okay, these two, three names are not important in terms of homeopathic approach, but it is important if you can understand how these things are kept in place. Once we know what all things are kept in place, we can you know, have an envision on how and why it is being displaced. Now the third one is the sphincter-like structure of the terminal arterioles. Okay, arterioles, there's a sphincter-like structure. Any change, any structural deficit in that will also cause a problem. The last one is fairly small calibers. Like I said, the sinusoids, the exchange of these things, or the hyperperfusion, like we say, the last two anatomical features also prevent the hyperperfusion of the sinusoids. So if it's some issue or some error is there in that structure, that also will lead to hemorrhoids. Now, how it is affecting the physiological aspect? First, how the change will happen is the sliding process of the analgesia. See, now the whole muscle, that is, or you say, the conjoint longitudinal muscle, the everything, if once it gets relaxes, it starts to slide. Sliding process of the analgesia is what is of late the accepted norm for the hemorrhoidal condition. Before and all, they had a theory that hemorrhoidal was basically varices of the hemorrhoidal plexus, but it has been disproved, and this is the sliding process of the analgesia is what being considered. And like I said, the sliding process of the analgesia is based upon all those things, factors. These four anatomical factors, any place that is getting lying means it will cause the first issue. Also, all the remaining three issues, like the deterioration of the connective tissue of the cushion, the reduction of the venous return from the sinusoids to the SRV, that is superior rectal vein and middle rectal vein during defecation. What is this reduction of venous return from sinusoids? When we defecate, it actually pushes out all the blood into the SRV and the MRV. Talking about internal hemorrhoids area, because that is the true area of the hemorrhoids. But there is a reduction of that speed. There becomes an engorgement there, and it swells. And now when the defecation is having, suppose constipated, even diarrhea, there will be a scraping happening, and all those engorged small sinusoids will break off. Am I making myself, are you able to understand? Fall, I'm hoping that you're all able to understand. Now the fourth one is the stagnation of blood inside. This is what I have, third and fourth point only I have mixed and explained to you. That is when the blood is coming and properly draining off and carried out, the defecation process is normally happening. But when it is not properly passed on, what will happen? There is a stagnation of blood inside the dilated plexus. Okay? And this hole has already started the body to function in a hemorrhoidal condition. Now, before the last one is, if it's something happens, scraping happens, the bleeding will start to happen. So this is, when you see it first sight, it's quite complicated. You may not exactly understand what it is. So let me also see it in the other screen, because that share screen is not, yeah, okay. Just focus on the red things that has been marked. The rest of thing is the interconnectivity. All the etiological factors, how it is getting interconnected to different aspects of the four anatomical effects that I have mentioned in the previous slides, and how those interconnectivity has led to the formation of the hemorrhoidal condition. So if you can see, if a person is constipated, if a person is having the woman is having pregnancy too, somebody standing erect for a long time, straining for defecation, sitting on defecation, all this pressure will lead to reduction in venous return to SRV and MRV. Again, SRV, MRV is superior rectal vein and middle rectal vein during defecation. It also has other factors like prolonged attempt to evacuate. You're sitting on the laboratory for a long time. Sometimes it would be due to the constipation. Sometimes we are having difficult, somebody is having difficulty. But most of the time, if you see, it becomes a habitual thing. You sort of, people have a habit of reading newspapers or, reading books or just simply sitting on the laboratory and maybe smoking. So all those things actually is having a degenerative effect on our normal hemorrhoidal structure. Okay. Now, when, like I said, here, the first red one, reduction in venous return to SRVMRV during defecation, that will lead to congestion of sinusoids. This congestion of the sinusoid is interrelated to the relaxation of the connective tissue of the anal cushion. Relaxation of the connective tissue of the anal cushion is further interrelated with multiple points on the left side. Why the relaxation? It may be due to aging. Because of aging, there is impaired quality of collagen. There is relaxation of Reed's muscle and conjoint longitudinal muscle. This whole thing that you can see on the left side causes this relaxation of the connective tissue along with congestion of the sinusoid. It's all interlinked. This may cause that, that may cause this. It's like a cyclic vicious cycle that, overlapping vicious cycle that happens. Now, if you move on to the next third one, relaxation of the connective tissue of anal cushion leads to the anal cushion slides. Here itself, our basic hemorrhoid has taken place. Now, here the blood stagnation is a reason which has happened due to the arterial hyperperfusion of the sinusoid, decreased vascular, so everything related to the arterioles and erosion, newly formed blood vessels, all have an effect on the blood stagnation. That has led to the congestion of the sinusoids that further had gone into the relaxation of the connective tissue of anal cushion. Here, like I said, anal cushion slides. When you say anal cushion slides, the condition has developed, or the hemorrhoidal disease condition has developed. Now, further, it may grade it further into a more higher form, grade 4, total prolapse of the condition, or it may complicate. So that anal cushion enlarges and transforms to anal nodule, the prolapse of the anal nodule, incarceration, strangulation of the anal nodule. All this prolapse of the nodule will lead to increased mucus transfer. See, if you can see at the end, this again is related to the increased mucus in the perianal ring, which leads to itching, soiling, mild incontinence. Can you see everything is interrelated in one way or another? All etiology is interrelated to one way or another. Arteries being, arterioles and everything being interrelated with the blood stagnation, the relaxation of the Reed's muscle and conjoint longitudinal muscle by the age factors, straining factors, sitting factor, defecation factor. So all this overlapping is how it is being picturized in this slide. Actually, pretty much I've covered the etiology in the previous slide, but still, we'll just move on to it. Primary etiology. See, the hemorrhoid swelling occurs basically when the intra-abdominal pressure increases. And engorge with the blood. Now, let's say the constipation, I'll put constipation the higher one. The constipation will lead to straining, prolonged lavatory sitting, trauma, aging, like you had mentioned before, previously I said aging has an effect, diarrhea, chronic as well as acute, lack of fiber-rich diet. This is the socioeconomic thing that I was talking about. It's more in US, if you say, according to the statistics that has been provided. Reason about the lack of fiber-rich diet they have. They have more fat-based diet. So the body doesn't have fiber to digest the food properly, and it leads to constipation and the cycle continues. And hereditary. Now, I would like to enlighten about the hereditary factor. It is not in particular about the genetic factor that they're talking about. It is more or less about the cultural or the habitual thing that you have inculcated. Like when you are in a family, you have a same culture that you follow. So that hereditary pattern is there. Family level, not say much has been, as far as the studies that I have gone through has been mentioned. The hereditary, what they're trying to intend, according to my understanding, is this. The child eats what the mother gives. It follows up what the environment or the society, community, they continue in that modus operandi. And that is how it is categorized in this hereditary thing. Now, moving on to the secondary causes. Pregnancy is a normal natural process of increased intra-abdominal pressure. Pelvic, and the pelvic also you can see here, just showing my finger here. Yeah, pelvic, gravid uterus, uterine cancers, uterine neoplasm, ovarian neoplasm, abdominal condition, ascites, local cause if you ask, anorectal deformity, hypotonic sphincter, there is portal hypertension, then previous any rectal surgery, any injury to spinal cord in improper posture, that's like the prolonged sitting, we said, no, initially we said sitting or standing, so improper sitting position is also a very important cause for hemorrhoids. Neurological, like paraplegia, multiple sclerosis, that's self-explanatory, the whole musculature is being, system is getting affected. So definitely the incontinence is there, the discharges will be there, the proper functionality has affected. So these are the secondary causes. The classification I've actually, in a way, I had explained before itself, but in this slide, you classify piles, or we classify hemorrhoids under three categories. Primarily into, like I said, there is a dentate line and pectinate line that divides into internal as well as external. But the condition are sometimes the patient has both, you know, they have the internal as well as the external. So that we call as a mixed hemorrhoid. So if you can see in the place, if the origin is below the dentate line, it is known as the external hemorrhoids. And if it is above the dentate line, it is known as the internal. But see, you can see it has been originated here and it's getting mixed with the external part also. So this is known as the mixed one, where both external as well as the internal has been involved. No? Signs and symptoms. Grading of hemorrhoid. This is the grading which I was speaking, that the more the grading happens, the more problematic the condition becomes. Now, the stage one and all is not exactly, a life-threatening issue. But it's a start of something which, if not checked, may lead here. Most of the people have, they get arrested with stage one or stage two to push it. I'm not denying it doesn't push to stage three and stage four, but it gets, if proper treatment is handled, this is a very good stage for all medicinal treatment from our side. Now, if you can see, stage one, no protrusion of hemorrhoids yet. Stage two, protruding hemorrhoids that spontaneously reduce. Just when the strain is coming, it is protruding, which you can feel, where the patient can feel there is something is coming out, some tissue is coming out, but they can't visibly feel or touch or something, and it has gone. Three is, it has come out and digitally or manually the patient can push it inside. And the last one, grade four, is it's very difficult, impossible for the patient to push it inside manually because of the severity of the pain and the condition. According to this gradation, there are certain signs that we can see. The first degree is more for bleeding with no prolapse. There will be itching and internal, I'll just move on to that next slide and there I'll explain. Now the second degree is prolapse with spontaneous reduction, with bleeding and seepage, that is mucus, secretion of the mucus. Third degree, prolapse requiring digital reduction, bleeding and seepage is there also. And the fourth, it cannot be reduced, which becomes a strangulated version. In a nutshell, if you say, now you can see first it's a painless rectal bleeding. This painless rectal bleeding is not for the external hemorrhoids, for internal hemorrhoids. Most of the time, the internal hemorrhoids are painless. That symptom is for that. Now, feeling of fullness or discomfort in the rectum, it's how it all begins. You know, you feel a bit of a discomfort, grade one. Discomfort, something is there, something is tough, the anus is full of something, where we mentioned in our medicines, ruta and all, like sticks and pricks and pins and all those things are the patient's way of expressing the signs, what they feel inside the rectum. There is pain in the rectum, it comes in internal hemorrhoids occasionally, which I'll explain. And external also it is there because the perianal nervous innervation is more during external hemorrhoids, not on the internal hemorrhoids. So anal pain will be there and itching feeling near the anus. Also, they can, if it is external, you can feel a lump, a hard lump for the inflamed hemorrhoid. Like I said, an internal hemorrhoid when swollen does not cause much pain, because they are covered by columnar epithelium, which lacks the pain receptors. Now, for internal hemorrhoids, bleeding is the most commonly reported symptom. During defecation, painless, and the blood is bright red, coats the stool, And if you can be a bit dramatic, like it's written, you just flash in the plan. We have always read in our classes, you know, when our lecturers used to just flash in the plan, just sprayed across the toilet paper sort of thing. But it dripping of the blood is also the sign of internal hemorrhoids without any pain. Now, another frequent symptom is the sensation of the tissue prolapse. Like I said, grade 2. Yeah, there's a sensation that something has come, but it is there. Prolapse is happening and it's simultaneously reducing by itself. The prolapsed internal hemorrhoids may accompany mild fecal incontinence, mucus discharge, sensation of perianal fullness, and irritation of the perianal skin. Why is this irritation of the perianal skin? It is because of the seepage of the mucus. The sanous liquid is getting seeped into it, and there is mild fecal incontinence. They can't, the sphincter doesn't work accordingly because of the cushions, because of the anal cushions incompetence. The 15-20% that it's supposed to support the internal anal sphincter to close the rectum is not functioning that properly. The continence is getting affected, and the mucus is getting seeped. Fecal incontinence is there. It comes and starts irritating at the anal end, which leads to itching. Now, pain is significantly less common, like I said before also, but if it is strangulated internal hemorrhoids or the prolapsed internal hemorrhoids, which leads to gangrene changes mentioned before, the avascular stages. I had been during the anatomy slide, I told you that the vasculature is there. It is a hemorrhoidal vasculature structure. But there are parts under that which is avascular, non-vascular. That ischemic nature associated with ischemia, this exchange of arteriovenous exchange, there happens ischemia. If the ischemia develops, it due to strangulated internal hemorrhoids leads to gangrenous change and then severe pain. In contrast, external hemorrhoids like the innervations are more. The perianal innervations are more. Pain sensitivity is more. So even if the slight swelling is there, even if the slight discomfort is there, it will pain very severely. And it is usually associated with thrombosis. Even while you're palpating it, the patient, even they don't have to even actually palpate. I have a case where patient won't be able to sit even when they showed me the picture, just slightly smaller one, but it's that severe pain they feel. Now, a thrombosis external hemorrhoid can occur when an underlying vein within the plexus, like I said, that's within the plexus. So if you remember during that venous thing, we have showed that external hemorrhoidal area, external hemorrhoidal plexus area, in that any underlying vein inside that plexus is having any clot, rapid stretching of the skin during the defecation process will cause severe pain because of the perianal innervations. Now, bleeding can also occur if ulceration develops from the necrosis thrombosis. This is talking about external hemorrhoids, okay? Now, external hemorrhoids, when there is necrosis happening of the thrombosed hemorrhoid, it will occur. But this blood tends to be darker and more clotted. Like, see, that is a tone that I've used to highlight there. This is sort of the color that it gets. Then the bleeding from the internal, which is bright red. So once the patient is like, it's being bright red and, red, that means it's just internal hemorrhoids. I'm not saying just, it is the internal hemorrhoid. Now, painless external skin tags often result from previous edematous or thrombosed external hemorrhoids. Now, the thrombosed external hemorrhoids that I had said, we have been mentioning this, when it comes for the 48 to 72 hours, it's paining very severely. But as the course goes, within 4 to 5 days, it will self-heal and it will shrink. Eventually, it will convert itself into the skin tag. Okay? The hard, painful lump can be felt at the anus. This is for the external hemorrhoid. Now, diagnosis. Now, before I talk about diagnosis, I would like to just say one thing. When I was in college, I had this notion in my thing that we have been taught that we have to look only at the symptoms. We have to look at the constitution. Why do I have to study surgery? Why do I have to study all those things? Why do I have to diagnose for that same part? If the patient is coming, I just have to, listen to the symptoms and give the medicine. I actually question what our master himself had mentioned, that it is important that the should know the disease condition, should be able to understand and diagnose the condition so that we can understand the limitation of it, so that we can work upon the limitation as much as possible to deliver the proper cure for the patient. Now, in the diagnosis for this also, for any condition likewise, here also diagnosis has a very important role to play. This, almost all of us know, clinically diagnosed when this, the patient will come. Clinically, symptomatically, they are saying, say, splash of the symptom, they are saying, they say, it's painless bleeding is happening. I'm having, you know, when you take the clinical history of the patient, we will know that, yes, this is the patient is talking about piles. The clinical symptoms, or the physical examination is there. The per-rectal examination, if you see, it will not elicit much of the internal hemorrhoidal conditions because it's too deep inside. But however, if it is strangulated, if there is gangrene, necrotic, pain is there, we will know there are changes. If not, there is like hypertrophy of the anal papilla. That anal papilla hypertrophy will make us analyze that some difference in the texture of the canal. External, it is painful. Easily we can identify. So for that, we have endoscopy, proctoscopy, that's colonoscopy, sigmoidoscopy, all these investigatory techniques we can use for diagnosis. Once diagnosis is required, because differential diagnosis is, we have to rule out, you know, we have to rule out which the condition is, what the condition, the primarily the patient is suffering from, what is the reason why it has come to this point, what all the journey this patient took throughout that has made the body to react in particularly this particular zone. Now, what is the history behind? So all those things is, you know, we get to know the details through diagnostic techniques. Now, if you move on to the, like here, differential diagnosis, foreign bodies, abscess, perianal abscess and all, it is like, it actually, we, most of the time we may get confused with the external hemorrhoid because it's very closer to the external hemorrhoidal plexus. But the difference is mucosal discharge will be more than that. Pain will also be different. Again, that's the reason it's under differential diagnosis. Polyp is there, anal polyp, that also will mimic external hemorrhoids. Now, carcinoma, intussusception, fistula in ANO, fissure in ANO. These are minor differences symptomatologically itself we can identify, but has to be considered a differential diagnosis. IBD, inflammatory bowel disorder. You can actually include inflammatory bowel syndrome also, sorry, irritable bowel syndrome also. And anal warts are known as condyloma acuminata because the thrombosed part has gone to the skin tag and we may think it is anal wart, whereas it is a history of external thrombosis, hemorrhoidal thrombosis. Prevention. We as a homeopath have to give a lot of importance to prevention and dietary thing, because our master has always said that is that the dietary thing as well as the maintaining cause removal and all affects our medicine, how the medicine reaches the body, how the medicine is absorbed by the body. Now, in this condition, 5 easy way is what is written in the right side. Like eat high fiber foods, drink plenty of fluids. Most important thing that we don't do, even we preach, we want to go to the nature's fall, but at some point of time we can't, so we try to control it, you know, we try to restrict ourselves from going, but that is against the nature. For some time it is okay, but for people who are frequently doing it, their strength of the musculature and the whole process get affected. So go as soon as you feel the urge. Important exercise. The exercise strengthens the muscles throughout the body. It's not a single part effect that exercise has. If you exercise even for half an hour a day, it actually, from the mind onwards to each and every cell of the body, it makes a huge difference. It strengthens the musculature. And avoid long periods of sitting. That's not only for hemorrhoids, that's for many of the other conditions, starting with spondylitis, back, severe back pain, low back pain, everything is common in this slide, if you can say. And most important, maintain healthy weight. Obesity is also one of the primary cause for hemorrhoids, because your the intra-abdominal pressure increases, and eventually the primary reason for hemorrhoidal condition is the raise in the intra-abdominal pressure. Now let's come to the homeopathic approach. Okay. Now, the true pathognomonic symptoms of a given case are those that cover the existing active asthma. In short, we have to abide with one baseline, that any medicine can only act giving cure if it is miasmatically based. Okay? This is the base, constitutional prescription, starting from lower potency and working upon it, unless and until you're very sure. But usually the conditions, especially in hemorrhoids now, it's always best to start from lower potency. Avoid frequent repetition. This I learned very hard way. I had a case which I actually genuinely spoiled my own case because I frequently repeated it. I'm saying this so that somebody else will not do it. You have a tendency to frequently repeat when we see a slight change, but we expect much more better. You know, we say, suppose out of 10 symptoms, I have seen 3 symptoms being ameliorated. There is a subconscious level when you're starting off that, oh, 3 has gone. If I give just some a little bit more, maybe 2 more will get reduced and, you know, the rest will follow. That doesn't happen. Already the process has started. So even if there's a slight change in the temperament, even if there's a slight change in any of these symptoms, don't touch or think about any other remedy. Just wait. Wait for a particular, you know, you will see, you by experience, you will understand how far you have to wait depending upon the patient, depending upon the patient's reaction or response to the pain or sensations. Now, single remedy. How do you start with single remedy? Because it is easy for us to handle, understand, change, and connect to or follow up if it is a single remedy. If you give multiple remedies, you yourself do not know which remedy actually caused what. So it's that's what how our master has always said. Give single remedy, minimum dose, avoid frequent repetition. And I would like to speak about constitutional prescription. We all talk about constitutional prescription as individuality, you know, identifying the individual, identifying the constitution. Now, the constitution of a patient is made primarily by 3. First, the one which he was born. Second, the one which he was trained during his childhood. Third is the environmental factors. Now, the first one is how the child was born, what sort of thing he has, you know, he grappled of understanding. Second is what he has trained, what the parents have trained, what the situation at that particular particular environment where he has grown has trained. Last is environment, that what, how he has learned all those things and now how he is willing to respond. All these things constitute a constitution, or that itself makes individuality. Now, when I said about the diagnosis also, there also this point is there. When you give a diagnosis, when you undergo a diagnosis, okay, this is the condition, this is the Pyle's condition, that diagnosis of a disease condition is one. But how the patient is reacting to the disease condition, what all symptoms the patient is showing with respect to the disease condition, that is the second one. That is more important than the second one. However, we cannot ignore the second one, that is disease diagnosis, we cannot ignore. Okay? It's not equally important, but it is important. Primarily, importance will always be how to understand the patient and how to elicit the individual symptoms or individual responses towards the condition of the patient. Now, see, while I was going through the text, it's written that our master had included hemorrhoids under Sora primary. During the course of time, it has. I started reading it and I found out most of the famous stalwarts again have said it has psychosoric elements. Soric is applicable only in the initial stage. When the hypertrophy has started, when the pain has started, it will move on to psychotic myasa. I think Dr. Shimjit has raised his hand. Dr. Deepu? Hello? Hello? Yeah.
No bother. Dr. Shalini, you continue.
Okay.
Sometimes it happens. They will type in the chat box. No issues. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, like Mayasam, like I was mentioning about, the hemorrhoids are basically psychosoric. Psychosoric. And when do we say it is soric Mayasam? Like I said, when there is some discomfort or itching. Psychotic, like I said, when the rectal hemorrhoids with extreme sensitiveness and pain is there, it has become psychotic. Now, syphilitic myasa, we all know when syphilitic has started. Anything destructive, it has been drilled into it. Any destructive change happening to us, it is syphilitic. And here also, rectal fissures, hemorrhoids with putrid and fetid discharges, oozing of pus, sanious fluid, all conditions are syphilitic. Tubercular myasm is also there, where there is bleeding is there, fistulas, there are sinuses, and any pain or sensitivity which is higher than the psychosis, aggravated much more than the psychotic conditions, it will become under tubercular. Also, the cancers are also trimiasmatic, and it also comes under tubercular myasms also. Okay, this is a basic differentiation that we can do on the basis of the symptoms and the stages where it is coming. So on this basis, we have to take the medicine. If it is the patient is coming under the psoric myasm stage, look into that. If there is no other syphilitic symptom in that particular person, individual person per se, because what I'm saying about discomfort itching is based upon the disease symptomatology. Now this I have tried to group it into clinical few of the symptoms that you may see with respect to the rectal condition as a clinical condition, etiology condition, sensation, modalities, stool, and hemorrhoids. So clinically, sora people will have either constipation or early morning diarrhea. And etiologically, the patient will say, anxiety or, some preparation for an unusual event, come from fright, and overeating. Now, sensation is, again, soreness in the rectum, like I said, bruised, slight pressive pain, discomfort, itching, this all comes under the sora sensation. Now, modalities, if we speak about, like I said, diarrhea, early morning diarrhea, and cold exposure, overeating. This overeating thing I have found and repeatedly during the sora myasthenia thing is, what I could infer is, sora is the first thing that I started, we all agree as a homeopath, because our master has told us, and clearly we all agree with him. Now, it is like, it has spread, it has distributed to throughout, globally, throughout everywhere. And for that, it requires energy. And once energy is required, you need to eat. Now, overeating that may lead to obesity and may not lead to obesity. But the basic primary concept of overeating starts because of spreading nature. Okay, I hope you could make that correlation along with me. Now, it is ameliorated by pressure, warm drinks, and hot food. Stool. Stool will be obstinate constipation, hard stool with no desire or with ineffectual urge. Watery and offensive morning diarrhea, painless with rumbling and gurgling in abdomen. It's just like morning you go and you feel the gurgling, that is the rumbling and gurgling feeling that you feel. And there's but the differentiation is that is normal if you go and come back fresh. But there is an ineffectual urging going and you are not feeling, that I'm done. There the change has started already. Now, hemorrhoid is associated with, like I said, like discomfort and itching, constipation with alternates with hemorrhoids. Okay, now we move on to psychosis. In psychosis, we can see prolapse of rectum, blind hemorrhoids, polyp conditions. Etiology, diarrhea from change of weather. Sensation, that is the stitching pain in the rectum with pulsating sensation during the stool. Modalities, these conditions are all aggravated, like primarily we said, change in weather. Cold, getting wet, eating fruits, And you feel better when you're lying on your abdomen or there is pressure on the lower part of the abdomen. Okay. Now comes the stool part. It's like jet-like expulsion of feces. Phlenismus with slimy stool, polychromatic and acidic stool, sour, corrosive, grass green color, often fish brine odor, always with colic and pruritus. Okay, these are the terms that has to be in my mind. When the, because the patient will not come and say, "My, you know, I have a fish brine color." So you need to understand what that exactly means. You need to just absorb it into your body. Neither the patient will come and say, "I have a very corrosive green grass green color a stool that I go in the morning." So how to elicit the symptoms is what your experience is about, and that is what you have to train yourself to. Now, hemorrhoids is rectal hemorrhoids with extreme sensitiveness and with pain that we have said in the first line of the Mayasa. Then any extreme sensitiveness, pain is there, it moves on to the psychosis. Now we'll move on to the syphilis part. Syphilis, destructive degenerative changes. The perianal abscess, fistulas, dysentery, and irritable bowel syndrome or diseases with mucus and pus. Diarrhea, etiology is diarrhea at seaside, one of the etiology. Sensation, the burning and bursting sensation, severe pain. Modality is aggravation at night from warmth. If you know the syphilinum drug also, it's everything is night aggravation. Stool, lymphedema, recurrent cough and cold during dentition, followed by diarrhea, black and extremely offensive with scrapings of intestine and mucus, indigestion and extreme weakness. Now, if you look into the hemorrhoids, there will be rectal fissures, hemorrhoids with putrid and fetal discharges, ooze, pus, and sanias fluid. Sanias is like serum, pus, and mild blood, like that sort of mixture is known as sanias fluid. Sora, psychosis, syphilis. Sora, we have known. Psychosis, we have completed. Syphilis, we have understood a bit. So we know how the gradation has happened in that sora, psychosis, and syphilis. I'm hoping that all of you are with me and all of you are understanding. Now comes about the tubercular part. Like there are many other constitution, miasms that has been given by many of the stalwarts, but I have chosen these four as of now because this is what I personally am comfortable following. Now the clinical condition for tubercular, the bleeding hemorrhoids, like I said, the first side of the miasm. The bleeding hemorrhoids and polyps, here also IBS will come with blood. There it was just mucus and pus, but here it will be with blood. Now recurrent fistula, abscess, sinuses, cancers, psychotic and tubercular miasms are mixed into it. Now least etiologies, least exposure to cold brings on diarrhea. Psychosis had change of weather. Change of weather will bring on to the diarrhea. But tubercular it is, a least exposure to cold brings on the diarrhea. And there is an alteration of rectal diseases with heart and chest affection. That is tubercular nature. We know tuberculinum. So there is an alteration of the rectal diseases with heart and chest affection. How do you sense it? The sensation is of the portal congestion with heat and flushing in and around the anus. The portal congestion is there with the heat and sensation of the around the anus. Modalities like syphilis, it also has an aggravation at night, but like Sora, it has an aggravation in early morning. Okay, both of it is same here. Now, they get aggravated with cold, milk, meat, potatoes, fruits. Fruits aggravation is with psychosis. So that also we can say here, oily food. Stool is obstinate constipation. Greenish, bloody or yellowish. Now you see, last we said green, like in psychosis, we said the grass green color. The patient will come, will not be able to specifically say that. They will say it just went green. Now it's up to us to elicitate based upon the other factors, etiology, modalities. What sort of green is he talking about? Whether it's bloody, just greenish, with yellowish, ashy or gray due to lack of bile. Because it affects the liver region. Now offensive, musty or moldy smell like rotten eggs. Painless diarrhea with bleeding per rectum. At night or early morning, driving the patient out of bed. Now, hemorrhoids. Now, bleeding hemorrhoids, suppression or operation may result in asthma like lung difficulties or heart troubles. There is this alteration also is seen into tubercular myasa. This is one case, only one case, because exactly 1 hour has happened. So I have a few of the medicines also discussed. So I've just taken one case for explanation, which I had, which is one of the most favorite. I know as a physician, we should not have a favorite or non-favorite, but this is my favorite because this effect or difference I just saw immediately. So I thought I'll just take that case and explain to you about the pyosulids. It's about a woman, 30 years. She's a college lecturer. She's suffering from bleeding, painful bleeding, post-delivery, second delivery. Now, she had a history of external pyosulids. She had treated it with allopathic medicine. Pain, when the time she had come, she had severe pain. I'm not mentioned here, but when she had entered my chamber, she was not smiling. She was totally unhappy. And she just came and sat with her husband. Her husband is the one who made her to come because he didn't want her to take allopathic medicine. He believed in homeopathic medicine. It's not that this woman didn't believe in homeopathy, but her pain was so severe that she wanted something to just reduce that pain. That's all she was thinking. Now she was asked to sit here. She was totally uncomfortable. Where she had said that her appetite is reduced for past 2-3 days. I'm not feeling hungry. Thirst is normal. This is the expression she's having. My appetite is reduced. Yeah, thirst is normal. When I asked what sort of water you like, she's like, I don't like cold water, that's all. Like when I next asked, how is your sleep? You know, do you get fresh sleep morning? She just 2 seconds, she looked at me. And literally, I could understand that she's thinking, why all those questions? I need something for my pain. But these all should be taken into account. Because this sort of a body language only made me to give something very basic medicine. Then stool ineffectual urging. Then she prefers spicy items, non-vegetarian, chicken, sour food, disagrees. Then I said, do you always get angry fast? And she said, no, I only get angry when in pain, and I don't like when kids make sound when I'm angry. I'm a lecturer and I can't listen. Whenever college students are making sound, off late I'm getting very angry and I'm shouting at them. I'm literally shouting at them, but I'm very much discomfort and I'm very much of pain. That's the reason I'm doing it. I think most of you would have guessed what I have given, because at that point of time, I did not repertorize, because this is actually 3 years before case. Five years before case. I didn't repertorize at that point because somewhere in my mind, the way her whole demeanor, the way her symptoms were speaking to me, I gave her the medicine.
Ma'am, there are some suggestions from the chat box, like Max Formica. Sure.
Ah, lovely, lovely. Absolutely. Who said Max Formica?
By many doctors, ma'am. Max Formica was said by majority of the doctors, ma'am.
Oh, wonderful. So I'm very happy that even with the repertorization, most of us have agreed that we can understand elicit symptoms, and if we can channelize that properly, we have arrived at the prescription. And thank you. And congrats for those who found out the answer. It is. I gave her Max Formica, actually 2 doses. One I gave immediately then and there itself. And I asked her to keep it SOS. Keep it with yourself. Give me a call tomorrow or day after tomorrow. If your pain doesn't subside, I will tell you how to have it. But just don't have it without getting permission from me. And I gave her the second best prescription. And also MAC4 6X I gave to morning and night for 5 days. After 15 days, she came for the follow-up. Patient was relieved of complete pain. Actually, the very next day, the full pain went. But according to her, by night, when she had traveled from the clinic to the house, half of her pain had gone. And she was inclined to take the second packet of powder. She came forth and said, doctor, I wanted to take the second dose of powder, but it became very night. It was at 11 o'clock. I did not want to call you. And so I did not have it. By the time next day morning happened, she did not have any pain. So, and she didn't use the second dose, but she gave it to me and of course we discarded it. She came again for 2 more times for follow-up, not because she had any signs and symptoms, but she wanted to have that, mind, okay, now I'm completely cured. They didn't go for any examination also, that investigation or diagnostics tools, nothing, because till now, there is no remission. Every year she will come for getting her supposedly constitution medicine. But if there are no symptoms or no signs in other conditions or health problems she's suffering, I just give the second best prescription and give most of the counseling for her to relax. Her condition is, if it comes, if it recurs, we will look into it that time. But she's pretty much very healthy after that first dose. And just Masformica, 31 dose. There's only one case I would like to share because already 3-5, I can see the time. Now, there are a few of the homeopathic
medicines. No worries, ma'am.
Okay. So, because I have a few of the medicines, I was like, I'll just hurry up. If after the medicine I have time, I'll just orally communicate one or two cases. Okay. So, now this one is homeopathic medicines. Most of us do know, and it's really available. And all the textbooks. But I have taken it and categorized it initially for a few slides. You will see under the heading of that you can search in rubrics, any rubric, any whether it be radar, complete dynamics, you can just use this as the main rubric. Under hemorrhoids, you have these many medicines. I'm not going to read out. Hemorrhage we have, very commonly we know is about aconite. And the pain, it came in between here. Ace plus, ammonium, carb, nuts vomica, pyonia, phosphorus, pulsatilla. These are all constitutional based also, and sometimes acute based. So let me be very honest, even constitutional based medicine, you can't give the time of acute unless and until it is like literally indicative of that. It's right and fair enough to say you can always, during the acute stage of that disease condition, give what that acute condition is demanding. Don't go for constitutional at that point. You just can wait. The patient has got back to the equilibrium or balance of the system. You may move then, finish the case with constitutional. You may, after one or two acute, may follow like a chain reaction. One medicine is given, it can be followed with another remedy, and then the case can be closed with a constitutional remedy. I can see 67 chat. I suppose all are following up and they don't have much of the doubt. No.
There are doubts now.
There are doubts. Okay. Yeah. Now, next is the moisture. Category, that's catarrh, that we said a seeping, itching thing we feel, mucus thing we can feel, all those things that comes under, we can categorize under this. We can categorize under itching, these for this group of few medicines that I have put into. And prolapse, we know, nux vomica, lycopodium, apis mellifica. Ignatia is also good. Sepia is also good. See, sepia, we know uterine prolapse is there, but actually it's good for rectal prolapse also. Muriatic acid is there. And itching, like sulfur, our king. Then we have natural carb, then calicarb. Carb groups of medicines are also very good in here. So you can see ammonium carb, calcarea carb. Yeah, I'll just move on to the next slide. There are a few things that few of the medicines I have taken in particular and explained only the hemorrhoidal part. Okay, so I'll just read out only one or two points of that. So in the arsenic aisle, if you can see the hemorrhoids that burn, it's sits bad. We say sits bad for hemorrhoids. We say cold and hot, that sort of thing. So this arsenic album has hemorrhoids that burn, which is relieved by sitting in hot bath or from heating pad. Now, there is stitching pain when walking or sitting, but not when it's stooled. Okay. And the hemorrhoids will bleed and protrude and are swollen. The burning pain is intense at night, which will prevent them from sleep. Now, about caustica. Now, hemorrhoids are... There is stinging, burning pain so intense that walking, standing, sitting, all the three processes are very painful and the portion is very difficult to touch. You can't touch that area. And the pain is somewhat relieved after a stool because the canal is empty now. So it has been evacuated, defecation has happened. Now, thinking about the hemorrhoids, this last thing is common for caustica. It's not only thinking of any complaint makes them, whatever the primary complaint is, if they think about it, it makes them feel worse. Bleed very rapidly, not like profuse bleeding is there, and frequently at the time of a stool, feeling of burning, soreness, and a sense of rectal fullness. The pain will remain long after stool, unlike causticum. Once the defecation is done, he feels better. But hemamelis, it will remain. It will persist there for a longer time even after the stool has passed. Then nitric acid. Now, acid group itself, we know how it is. Like burning, pricking, sharp, stitching pains often after every bowel movement. Now, bowel movements can be very difficult even when soft and very painful. Now, nitric acid has a urine also is a very characteristic, peculiar urine which we can elicit. And if the patient is having, then very good. Very good symptom for us to prescribe that. Now, bleeding of the hemorrhoids, sometimes in bed at night, as well as great sensitivity of the anus and itching. All these things are worse from exercise for the patient. That's vomica. This is, I think, most of you know. So I'll just, you know, ineffectual urging, burning pain from loss, intolerable to the least touch, discharge of bright blood, copious in amount, urging again and again to stool, cutting pain in anus, hours after passing the stool, similar to hemamelis, constipation is there, hemorrhoids with burning and sticking pains, itching is there, which will make the patient to be awake throughout the night. This better by sitting in a cold water in contrast to that of the RSAL, but the patient is better when he or she sits in a hot water. Okay, lying on the abdomen, it is a feeling better, that becomes a psychotic miasmatic symptom. Now, hemorrhoids are worse from being sedentary or from so-called high living and can be a problem during pregnancy or after childbirth. Now, sepia and sulfa. Sepia, like I also said, for prolapse, it's a very good remedy. Now, hemorrhoids that are hot and burning with the swelling of anus when the hemorrhoids do not protrude. Now, painful passing of stool with constant oozing of moisture from anus, as well as stitches and jerking pains from the anus upward into the rectum and abdomen. There's itching in the rectum and anus and constipation. Sulfur, again, most of us know it's like it's inside us. We have just digested it. But again, but it's very important for all, especially in the itching phase or grade or stage of hemorrhoids. Intolerable itching with no large red burning and itching hemorrhoids. It will very, like they say, that the child will cry to pass the stool. The same thing is, even when they're adult, they find it very difficult. They find it very irritated during this hemorrhoidal condition to pass. There is shooting pain in the anus that at times travel upwards. The burning pain worse after sitting a while and after soft stools in the evening. So there is a sense of fullness and pressing in the rectum during and after the stool. They prefer warmth of the bed and in general, they don't like that. And worse from bathing. That is like standing and bathing and warmth of bed and all those things are the aggravating factors. Few more. This I have compiled from one of the articles. So here, when there's Calimmune, like Kent, hemorrhage from rectum, congested hemorrhage. Okay, worse from walking. Then Clindam arsenicosum, again by Kent, bleeding from anus. Calisilicatum, sulfur iodatum, arsenicum sulfuratum and flavum, Senkris. That's another medicine, very good medicine for that will itch. Then Calliars, Calcarea silicata, Abrotanum, Erigeron, Allosocrotina. That also we know it is similar to that of Nux vomica. We have that pain, blind things associated with hemorrhoids, abdominal pains that will drive him crazy. Podophyllum, stool, just jet explosion like stool, portal engorgement, the tendency to have hemorrhoids, hypogastric pain, fullness of superficial veins, ammoniamune, calibichrome, sulfur like I mentioned before, ferrum, vaithya, there's itching of anus with constipation with hemorrhoids and not bleeding, blind thing will be there. Hemamelis also have influence. Hypericum is with pain and bleeding and with tenderness. Yeah, lycopodium clavatum, hemamelis. I think lycopodium and all we have covered before. These are the references that I have taken. Oh, I have taken 15 minutes extra. like always, or like a master says, the physician's highest calling, his only calling, is to make sick people healthy, to heal as it is. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Shall I stop sharing?
Yeah, we can have some doubt session.
Yeah. Then it will be like, if they want, I can go to the screen once again, like that particular slide.
Okay.
Ma'am, many participants were requesting the slides of psoriatic and psychotic myosin.
Okay, I shall go there then.
No, you better share the slides. That will they will use those slides.
Share the slides. Shall I give to Dr. Deepu?
Yeah.
Okay. So I can open the chat, right? Shall I stop sharing and then open?
Yes, ma'am.
You can stop sharing. Nobody will ask you the question.
Okay. Ma'am, there is a question from Dr. Tripti. Can third or fourth stage be prevented if it is blind piles or non-bleeding piles?
Blind piles or non-bleeding piles. See, prevention is always if the patient will approach you at the right time and you are able to identify the condition as a blind pile. There is the role of diagnosis coming.
Okay.
So once you are able to diagnose its piles, because it is blind piles, it's difficult to diagnose unless until you go with an investigatory techniques. And if it's diagnosed, you can give the medicine and yes, we can definitely arrest.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, many people were asking to differentiate between the piles and fissure, anal fissure.
Yeah. See, it's a huge difference is there. The only thing is you have to elicit that from, if you want the symptomatology, you have to elicit that from the patient itself. How? Piles doesn't have, the cuts and cracks, and it doesn't bleed exactly like a stripe. When the stool is there, it will be marked. Fissures and all, when the stool will be marked, like a stripe, it will be seen over the stool. But piles, it is like coated. The stool is coated or like splashed. Few of the symptoms. Second, fissures have developed around the anal region. That is why we say hemorrhoids basically is internal hemorrhoidal conditions. External is... We always diagnose because of this fissure thing, perianal thing. So rather than that, it is better if you go with symptomatic thing. Ask the patient how, symptom of how the stool, blood if it's coming means how it's coming. Pain, particular pain, where the stitching, cutting pain is coming. Those few differentiating thing will help you to understand. Unless you have a diagnosis already done.
Okay, ma'am. Many participants... Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Many participants were asking why was Naxomica prescribed and why was Macfos prescribed?
No, Macfos is prescribed. It has a history with Macfos. And I thought I have found it very effective whenever there is pain is there. I have seen Mac. I personally have used as well as prescribed for people who get pain at that time that immediate relief. Take 2 to 3 tablets of Macfos 6S. Powder it. Take it in, 1/4 cup of water. And take it, just gulp it down. Within 10 to 15 minutes, you can see marked reduction in the pain, unless and until there's a literal, inflammatory reason going on. It's just a mild thing for making the patient comfortable. Now, why Naxomica was selected was, the first and foremost thing, she was very angry when she was answering me. And I could sense her innate ambitious nature. And there's one thing I do not know whether I have mentioned. I said it's unrefreshed sleep. The unrefreshed sleep when I had elicited, she said that she has to go to the college. Okay. And so she wakes up at the morning. In the morning about 4 o'clock, she prepares everything. She cooks everything. And she's fresh. But by the time she has to go to the college, she's feeling sleepy. It's somewhat resonated with that of the sleep symptom of Naxomica. That along with the way her approach towards answering the questions made me prescribe Naxomica and other disease symptom similarities was there.
Okay, ma'am. There is a query from Dr. Archana Harish. She's asking about the external application in case of hemorrhoids, ma'am. Like ointments.
I haven't advocated external application for hemorrhoids like ointments. But yes, if there is too much of itching, I have asked them to take mother tincture echinacea and apply externally. So just like, keeping it clean. If the mucus is coming, pus is coming. But ointments, I don't usually
Okay. Ma'am, this question is from Dr. Krishna Madhuri. Ma'am, is there any reduction of fourth grade hemorrhoids after homeopathic prescription?
This is a very tough question, ma'am, to be honest. That is a skill level based question. If you are highly skilled, I would not be able to say on that, comment on that particular thing. Because personally, I will say that we have a limitation when it comes to the surgical intervention. I will take any grade 4 piles only after the surgical intervention is done, and post-operative care and future recurrence of that condition can be avoided using that.
Okay. Okay.
Yes?
Yes, ma'am. There was one question from Ilakya Ram, Dr. Ilakya Ram. Does hemorrhoids lead to perianal abscess?
You cannot say it leads to perianal abscess, sir. It's two different condition. It may overlap because, especially the external, because perianal abscess is, that position is near to the external hemorrhoidal abscess. So it may overlap. Two conditions may coexist together. I haven't got any case where it will be one leading to another.
Okay.
Because pressure is there, so it may.
Okay. Ma'am, there is another query from Dr. Archana Harish. Should a pregnancy in Naxwamika, if indicated, can be prescribed and in what potency?
So Naxwamika during pregnancy, we say it is good. But any potency, we have to decide as a lower one to start with. Okay? I haven't got any pregnancy case with Naxwamika prescription that I have to give. But even so far, so even though technically we will say lower potency, and that is a safer one to go also.
Okay. Okay. Ma'am, this is a query from Dr. Manju. Please give some information about sentinel pile.
Lovely. Now that is something that I haven't referred, so I will not be able to tell you in detail today. So if you want that, I can get the details through Dr. Deepu. Is that thing fair, sir?
Yes, ma'am, you can. Sure, ma'am.
Yeah, it's okay.
Ma'am, many doctors were asking, is there any specific remedies you use in case of hemorrhoids?
No, none. I don't use specific remedies.
Okay.
I've been told there are many, but I have not found that much of use. I haven't tried using it because most of the time, whenever the symptomatologically based, I give the prescription, I find the symptoms has subsided. So okay. I don't have to. Yeah.
Okay. And there is also one more query. How should we manage in the cases if hemorrhoids and fissures coexist?
Find a medicine that will cover both the symptoms.
Okay.
Like I think in one of the slides, there is an answer. Both of the medicine, like hemorrhoids as well as fissures are coexisting, you can give that medicine. I think Pioneer.
Okay.
See, to be honest, to all the doctors out there, remember that always diagnosing the patient individuality based upon the symptoms is the primary thing. Terminology is important, equal not to the equal level as that of the diagnosing individuality of the patient. So if we are finding fissures and hemorrhoids, how can I give is not exactly a question unless and until you are looking only on the diagnostic condition of the disease. Am I making sense? These two things are based upon symptoms on which we have to take the medicine. So whether it be fissure, whether it be hemorrhoids, even if it is overlapping, there will be multiple disease condition a person is having. Primarily, the focus will be that, but eventually we are taking the whole system as a one. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. So, sir?
Yeah, just invite Dr. Rekha, ma'am. Okay. For the conclusion.
Yes. I kindly invite Dr. Rekha ma'am to deliver the vote of thanks.
Hello. Shalini, that was wonderful. You have compiled very well and you have shared your knowledge as well. Thank you so much for such a very apt and very nice presentation. Thank you so much, and we wish to have more such sessions from you. And also we thank one and all for attending this session and getting benefits. We thank you one and all. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much for inviting. And if I may, I'll just give the answer for that sentinel piles. Is it okay, Dr. Deepu?
Yes.
Now, because that is something is named as piles, but just like skin tag, I just now searched it. And I'm sorry that I just overlooked that thing because I was too focused on the piles. But that, see, that happens, that you forgot that what sentinel piles is just a skin tag. It's not it's a contagious part condition that has to be treated. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you so much, one and all.
Thank you so much for inviting. Thank you so much. And I hope doctors, all those participants have gained few things and understood the basics and could carry forward what you have learned in this session. And I shall pass on this these slides to Dr. Deepu. If anyone requires, please get through him.
We can share that in the Telegram group. No problem.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you.